It is 7 o'clock, so I would like to call to order the regular monthly meeting of the Sevastopol Board of Education, and we'll begin with the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Good evening. I would ask that we observe a moment of silence, please, in memory of the loss of Matt, one of our students this week. Very, very tragic loss to the entire community. So I would ask for a moment of silence, please. Thank you. Our thoughts are with his family and friends and the entire community at this very sad time. We do have a closed session this evening per Wisconsin Statutes 19.85, parens 1, parens C, considering employment, promotion, compensation, or performance evaluation data of any public employee over which the governmental body has jurisdiction or exercises responsibility, item A, administrator contract. We'll move to guest comments, and because we have a large number of people who would like to speak, we will begin with those who would like to observe the 3-minute time limit. And after that, anyone who wants to speak longer, we will accommodate them. We want to give everyone the opportunity to speak. And Mr. Beam is going to do the timing for us this evening. So we'll begin with Bridget Bowers and Lisa Bly.
The team from Sevastopol spent the last few days in Madison at a future rowdy school summit. We wore our pioneer clothes with pride, as we do here today, representing Sevastopol School. Bridget and I would like to take this opportunity to thank each and every one of you as board members for all the time, the effort that you have spent getting us ready and moving toward what's called future ready. The commitment, the dedication, and strategic planning that many of you have spent over the past many, many years shows your true commitment to the students, staff, and the Sevastopol community. Being at Madison, working with over 250 principals, superintendents, educators, and leaders on both the state and national level, made us incredibly proud of all that you have done in the planning to prepare us for the innovation, for the technology, and for the seamless integration. Many people do not have the opportunity nor the understanding of the enormous job and responsibility that you folks have. However, being at Madison for the last few days, working with this coalition, you as a board have made us very proud. Your planning and preparation and strategizing for many years really stood out, and it was very obvious at the summit. The Alliance for Education, the leader of future readiness in partnership with the U.S. Department of Education, and a vast coalition with national and regional leaders, we are well on our way, and you've given us a very good foundation. So, on behalf of both Bridget and I, we want to thank you for all you have done and all that you continue to do to make us proud at Sevastopol. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Ben Riccola.
As spokesperson for the parent community group, I'd like to explain how we arrived at this contentious point between stakeholders and some of the school board members of Sevastopol. First and foremost, we'd like to say that this recall is not personal. Most of you on the board can attest to the fact that you don't know me personally, and vice versa. I think the guy that I know the most is Jay Zahn in our time in Rotary together. as acquaintances and working on the shipyard tours, but that goes for a lot of folks involved in this. There's no grudge here. It doesn't matter who you are, what you look like, what your name is. We don't care about that. And the proof in that is that Sue Today and Bill Beam have been longtime board members, and nothing like this has happened to them before. There's an old joke in politics that the first job of an elected official is to get reelected. That simple one-liner is a turnoff to most Americans nowadays, but the punchline is actually not a joke, and it has its roots in an important American principle that government derives its power from the consent of the governed. What elected officials typically are worried about most is carrying out the will of the people, or else they won't be reelected. We all know this. Ultimately, the people rule, majority rules. We all talk about this in the wonderful country we live in where this is possible. We learn about it in school, how the founding fathers believed it is not just your right, but your civic duty to be involved in government, to ask questions, to exercise your rights of free speech, and to either provide consent or not provide consent to your elected leaders. And that's all that is happening here. In a nutshell, this community is no longer providing that consent. The recent recall campaign came about because the board went for months flat out ignoring stakeholders, constituents, and the vast majority. Early in all of this, the board did not so much as even give the stakeholders the time of day. Body language alone said, "Go away, you're a nuisance. Leave us alone so that we can do our job." And still to this day, that is the message from some. And that's the point. So many people who care about this place and who work at this place tried to help you stand why things were all messed up. And you refuse to listen. All of these people can't be crazy. All of these people have college degrees and master's degrees. We have doctors and lawyers who are backing our side. All of these people who are influential in their community, just like you, can't be backwards or upside down. But that's the message you conveyed, and that's why this recall has gained so much steam. Because of your unwillingness to listen, simply because of that, a recall initiative was the only option, literally the last resort to get your attention. What is painfully obvious to so many of us is that we did not bring any of this on. We did not tear this school to shreds in the last 6 months. It wasn't the parents that did that. It wasn't the taxpayers that did that. It wasn't the teachers that did that.
I'll give him my time.
The painfully obvious part is that if things were going splendidly, none of us would be coming to board meetings every Thursday. None of us would be involved in a recall. But it is indisputable that things have not gone splendidly. And when that happens, you have to know that it is only natural for people to question things rather than go along with things. There was a bigger school in Wisconsin that had similar turmoil recently, Grafton. A teacher was put on leave over an incident, and there was such an outpouring of support for that teacher that the board changed its mind, reinstated the teacher, and severed ties with the district administrator who initiated the leave. What's remarkable is that the whole ordeal took 9 days. The Grafton School Board listened to the people and executed the will of the majority, and the whole thing was over in 9 days. Compare that to here. Grafton is an example where the people's voices were heard loud and clear. Grafton is an example of not wasting tons of time and money on lawyers. Grafton is an example of keeping things simple and just listening to the people. All they needed was the court of public opinion, and it was done. If Grafton can do it, certainly Sevastopol can do it. But here, the outpouring of support is not valued. It's shunned. The whole community is wondering, at what point will you acknowledge the will of the people? And many fear that day will never come, which is why the recall had to happen. Still to this day, some of you continue to put more trust in a few rather than the overwhelming majority. During this last week of school, Mrs. Today was seen having a not-so-secret meeting with a certain staff member in the school parking lot. So in one instance, Mrs. Today tells staff that they cannot meet, cannot discuss, cannot reason with her. We don't want to micromanage, as I believe how it was stated, because staff must follow the chain of command. But then you have a not-so-secret parking lot meeting with one certain staff member. Why does that staff member get the privilege to meet with you in person? You see how this looks, don't you? This school is too small for certain board members to have alliances with certain staff members without everyone knowing about it. I'm sorry, you just can't be board president and say at board meetings that communication between board and staff is not allowed, and then be caught meeting with a staff member who's known to be on the other side of this.
30 seconds.
Things like this are precisely why this recall gained so much steam. All you had to do was give fairness and justice a decent shot. But instead you chose that the small faction was in the right and the vast majority are the crazy ones. Secret meetings, denying due process, unflattering pictures and articles in the paper, ignoring the majority, wasting thousands on lawyers' fees, taking forever to get anything done.
That's time.
You can have my time.
These are the reasons that you have lost public favor and consent of the stakeholders. There is one more point that everyone wanted to make. We want to make absolutely clear that the gains that have been made in the last few weeks, such as the meet and confers and the listening session tonight and the recent vote to pass the new salary schedule, would not have happened without new blood getting in on the board. The fresh perspective of Mr. Kakmarinski and Mrs. Ehlers has been a beacon of shining light in helping other board members who were run over up until mid-April. Never in a million years would the old board have gotten us to this point. So, I hope that provides clarity to everyone why this recall was necessary. And with that, I would like to introduce our recall petitioner, Christina Blackley, for an update on how the recall is going.
Good evening. My name is Christina Blackley. As the official recall petitioner, I would like to make a statement in regards to the recall of Bill Beam and Sue today. Roughly 6 weeks ago, I initiated the recall on behalf of concerned parents and community. The reasons for the recall are lack of transparency of the board and administration, inappropriate use of taxpayer money, and broken lines of communication. Per Wisconsin recall law, 743 signatures were needed to be obtained, which is 25% of everyone in the district who voted in the last gubernatorial election. Tonight, I would like to publicly announce that 824 signatures have been obtained for Mr. Beam and 829 signatures have been attained for Mrs. Today. Upon receipt of the petitions by School Board Clerk Lisa Berry, a verification process will be underway. Once the signatures are verified, we will publicly announce our candidates. After that is complete, a recall election will be sent. Clearly, the people have spoken. The citizens have had enough. No one can deny the fact that hundreds and hundreds of stakeholders feel that what is best for our school right now is change in leadership in order to restore the confidence in our system. Thank you for your time.
And just to clarify, Mr. Riccolo, there was no secret meeting. There was a chance encounter with a staff member as I was entering the building. Kevin Schultz?
Still communication with the staff.
Marcy Faustini?
Yes.
Kelly Asher?
I already gave my time.
Candace Warwick?
Pass, please.
Jerry Warwick?
Good evening. I'm going to make this fairly brief. Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. You didn't know.
Reminder that we'd like people to take 3 minutes.
Is this going to, does that count against my 3 minutes? The microphone?
No.
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Before I get into my main, I just want to sum up what was said before. And this is why I got into this. This really never had to happen. Had the governing board of this system here exercised its proper responsibility way in the beginning, when reports and concerns were flowing through, as stated, this could have been dealt with a lot easier, with a lot suffering throughout the whole region. What I'm questioning is this is really quick and it's just a question and it's no big confidential. Somebody can just tell me who did it. 2 weeks ago in the newspaper, when the big article appeared on all the issues going on here, on the second page there was a picture of the, quote, destroyed classroom. I just want to know who authorized the release of that picture at a time when you were looking for a new principal, and at a time when parents are making decisions whether or not to, through the choice program, to send their children to this school or another school, or people who have moved into the district now facing the question. I can't imagine any example of why anybody in administration or board would approve a destructive picture to be released to the public. In my business, it would be like a hospital releasing the picture of a patient who we just accidentally cut off their wrong arm and blasted in front of the public. I thought the role of the board, one of the roles of all governing boards, is to be cheerleaders for the organization which they are responsible for and are board members for. So I'm just asking the question, who released the picture and authorized it? It didn't come from
the
nowhere.
The advocate is right there.
Who released the picture?
I'm actually not allowed to take part in it.
They know.
But we actually had the picture released for us months ago by an unknown party. And then, in this particular picture, though, was released by Linda Underwood at my request.
So you released the picture. Mm-hmm. And that was, how does that appear to be a positive reinforcement of this school to the community? Do you have a response?
I'm not going to have a conversation.
You're not an elected official. You can engage in conversation. So anyway, if you release that, I think that's really poor, abhorrent, and there's no reason at all for the leader of the school to release a negative picture which displays your school, which we're trying to build up to the community. Shame on you.
Paul Kessriel.
My name is Paul Kessriel. I live at 4553 Glidden Drive, East Valmy. How I got involved in the recall was related to my surprise when Mary Donaldson's contract was not renewed. Under Mary's leadership, the elementary school has received recognition from the state, I believe for 2 years in a row, for academic achievement. So I found it very strange that Mary's contract would not be renewed. I come from the corporate world, and I kind of view the board as the board of directors of a corporation. I view myself as a shareholder. I'm a taxpayer. I view Dr. Underwood as the CEO of this corporation. Now, in my experience in the corporate world, when a division manager, like Mary Donaldson, she ran the division of the elementary school. When the division manager's division shows outstanding performance, it's very unusual in my world to see that division manager terminated. Rather, you usually see them promoted. Now, it's apparent, or it's not apparent, we don't know. We still don't know what caused this turmoil, but it does appear to have been some dispute between the CEO, Dr. Underwood, and Mary Donaldson. And it is the duty of the board of directors of a corporation, when there is some problem in the organization, to immediately go forth and try to resolve this problem. And I view the board's failure to do this as a dereliction of duty. And if I were a stockholder in a corporation and the board of directors acted as you have acted, I would call for your termination. And so that's exactly why I got involved in this recall. Thank you.
Katie Casriel?
Yes,
please. Crystal Malvitz?
Read this for the member that's missing tonight.
My name is Crystal. I am a parent, former employee, and volunteer here at Sevastopol for over 16 years. I have been seeing the good name of Sevastopol drug through the rubbish and gutter for some people. It seems to be intending and willing to do. I am speaking on behalf of other parents, grandparents, etc., that have not spoken due to fear of our children being mistreated because we want the truth to come out. There are certain teachers that are fueling anger, various people in this community that are filling their heads with untruth and lies. The board has been very clear in their multiple responses to questions on this matter. There are personal issues in this instance, personal issues that are regulated by state statutes as to their confidentiality. Let us not forget the entire board voted unanimously to not renew Mrs. Donaldson's contract. Anyone who is fueling the community members and filling people's heads with untruths and lies should be ashamed of themselves. They should be ashamed for continuing to destroy this school's community that so many of us love and believe in. I wonder why the people who are spreading these lies have to gain. What do they have to gain? Perhaps they receive special treatment in some way, shape, or form, or are hoping to regain that status. I am also puzzled as to why there are no reprimands, repercussions for individuals who are employed at this district. I am also puzzled and upset as to why various employees in this district put their names on documents and in the media attached to items that are critical of the school board and this administration. So I went to the school website where I found this information in the 2015 through 16 staff handbook. In the handbook of the employee under conflict of interest, it states, employees are expected to maintain high standards of honesty, integrity, impartiality, professionalism, conduct. Further, employees are expected to perform their duties in a manner free from conflict of interest, pursuant to 19.59 Wisconsin statutes. Based on the information and given the conduct of some employed by this district, it seems that the spirit of this clause should be invoked. There should be some sort of investigation on how their activities in and out of school are having a potential detrimental effect on their duties and functioning effect on the district as a whole. Are the actions of these employees truly serving the best interest of students at Sevastopol? Has there been some sort of investigation we know of? And how is this being addressed? When will it be addressed? Is the activity and conduct being addressed in the review process for pay raises and compensation? I would hope so.
Thank you. Don Donaldson?
I
First of all, let me say I've spoken once before, before the board. My name is Don Donaldson, 5156 Bayshore Drive, here in town. First of all, I think that everyone here, this is a great demonstration of democracy. Everyone's voicing their opinions, and I think that has been sorely lacking. So congratulations to this community. I'd like to read an email I got just a few minutes ago. It involves someone very, very dear to me. I've watched how in the last year and a half, she has gone through tremendous struggle because of the actions of a few people. She has suffered greatly, but she has learned a great many lessons about life. She has moved on. She has moved on because she did come to find that there are people in her life who love her, who care for her, and she came back to what those core realities are about all of our lives. She now is about to achieve something that all of us see as a milestone. In our family tradition, one of those, we talk about those in my classroom all the time, so what do you do as far as a family together? What are your traditions? And one of those is you need to share something at the dinner table, something positive that happened to you today. As a reminder that no matter what your day is like, there are good things. There are good people, there are good events, and you do overcome adversity. In the end, it's all good. As my friend Ben Babcock always says, it's all good. It always works out. So I was going to read you this email. And I believe that one thing that this district needs to start being reminded of, it wasn't reminded when the teachers achieved their state award. It was glossed over. There have been too many negative things. Each side has their opinion about what those things are.
30 seconds.
Graduation reminder. Dear Grace, good news. Our records show that you have a minimum of 132 credits and therefore are eligible to apply for graduation. If you intend to graduate within the next year, click on the link below to access online application. Please understand that submitting this online application does not guarantee that a degree will be granted from DePaul University. However, in order to graduate, you must complete the application. She has gone through hell. She has found her way out. I'm finishing right now. All of us students in this district and all districts deserve everyone to pay attention to them. Good students from good families, they all make it through. Our oldest is about to get married down in Madison. He would have done well in any school that he went to, any high school. He graduated with from Madison. He has started his own life, and he's about to move into that new part of our life once we get married and start a new family. Our middle son has started a new career and started new collegiate efforts over in St. Paul, and Grace is moving on. All of them have people that truly suspend all of their own drama, all of their own petty jealousies, their petty nonsense, and they pay attention, they sit down, and they talk. Both sides have things to talk about here. You have abdicated that responsibility. You have ignored it. And people have been saying it for months. You guys should have showed up. You needed to show up. There should have been an honest discussion. You should have done this before it ever went public. But the good news is that this girl who we love and who we have dedicated our lives towards, as all of us do with our own children, is moving on. And there was times we didn't think this was going to happen. So, it's awesome. Thank you.
Rachel Shortner.
Yes.
Tony Hayes.
Hi, my name's Tony Hayes. I live at 3058 Canal Road. I just have a question. We have a great turnout tonight. And I was wondering, why couldn't we post that we have school board meetings on the big sign out front? I noticed tonight that there's just a time and a date out there. It doesn't say school board meeting, 7 o'clock, Sevastopol School. I think a lot of parents dropping their kids off would use that, and it would remind them, you know, that the meeting is here. And I think we would have a lot more public opinion that way.
We can check into that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Kay Hain.
Yes.
Jan Kamarinski.
I guess my point that I want to talk about is my bubble has been bursted, and I like to live in a world of happiness. And this has been a really hard week of so much sadness in our world. And I just hope that we can all figure this out. And I love everyone at the school, teachers, students, board members. I just want to stop all the fighting. I just want us all to figure this out and do the best for our school. We had tons of kids die in Orlando. Little boy died with an alligator. My son's friend died. Life is precious. We need to count our blessings. We need to examine ourselves. Tell the truth. Get up every morning and look in the mirror. Look at ourselves and know, are we telling the truth? Are we doing the best that we can? Not be selfish. That's it.
Thank you. And Tracy Jones. Okay, that concludes our public comment section for this evening. I would like to announce that Jane Lubker is not able to be here tonight due to an out-of-state funeral, and Cindy Zellner-Ehlers is not able to be here due to some out-of-state travel. Board members, any correspondence that you have that you need to share? Linda, anything?
Thank you note from the Y for a donation.
Okay. We'll circulate that. I don't think we have any other guests. Any recognition this evening? We have consent agenda. Item A, to approve the accounts payable and financial reports. Item B, to approve the minutes of the regular school board meeting June 2nd, 2016. Item D, to approve a donation from Mr. Marvin Obrey, 75th anniversary Sevastopol yearbook. Could we have a motion, please, to approve the consent agenda items A, B, and D?
I move to approve consent agenda items A, B, and D.
And I don't believe we have any thing under item C tonight. Okay.
I'll second that.
We have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That is approved. Under reports, we don't have our student rep here tonight. We did receive electronically a report from Mr. Baer, particularly highlighting the plans of our graduating seniors, and it looks like they have some wonderful plans, ideas in store for them, and we wish them well in all of those things. We also had electronically from Mr. Siegel an update regarding the end of the year and some information regard to summer school. et cetera. So anyone have questions on any of those reports? Hearing none, we'll move to item C. Linda.
I just have a quick update on where we are in our vacancies. Invitations have been sent, calls have been made to people for the interview committees. We're waiting to hear back on some of those, and I'll feed that information back to the board in case you want to add people to the list to fill in for people who can't make it during our time period. I'm getting feedback on the groups of questions for each of the committee. And late today, we had, in addition to the 39 applicants for elementary principal, director of special ed, we have 60 applicants for dean of students, 18 plus three hard copy, 21 applications for special education, and 8 for the English position. So we'll keep cycling through those.
Okay, any questions or comments for Linda or anyone? Okay, a few updates. At our last meeting, I believe it was the last one, we talked about a possible study of support staff benefits. This is something that we've been looking at for a while and have not had the opportunity to do that. Somebody mentioned CESA 7 at the last meeting, so I did contact Jeff Dickert, the agency administrator, and he said that they could help us. He referred to Dr. Seifer, a retired superintendent from Gibraltar, and himself being available to do this work. And he said they can be as thorough as we would like. He thought perhaps to look at the 5 Door County school districts and then another 5 districts in the state that are similar in enrollment. So if the board would be interested in pursuing this, I would ask Jeff to come up and give a presentation and talk about the specifics on this and the costs that might be involved. And if there's anyone else that anyone has as a possible resource, we could have that person or persons come in as well.
Just a clarification, you had said a study of the support staff benefits. When we were talking about this fall, we were talking about certificated staff as well as support staff.
Oh, okay. We could have Jeff talk about that. Okay. So is this something I see a lot of?
Yes, I think we should have some income tell us what they can do and what it'll cost.
If there was a quicker way through like the Department of Labor, if they have lots of that data available, which would be more cost and more available, but I don't know if that,
I think
there's a certain body of data that exists with the Department of Labor, but I don't know how it's broken out and stuff like that.
Bill, I know, has talked in the past about some of this.
And, take a look into that.
Yeah. Okay, I will check with Jeff and see when he can come. I'll try to get him here as soon as possible. And then while we're on CESA, just a note that the Educational Television Productions organization and CESA 7 have now merged. Educational Television Productions did the Teen Institute, if you've seen some of those on TV. They also did the highlights on Channel 11, sponsored by Bellin, on Your Public School Experience. And that group has now merged with CESA 7. CESA 7 did some video productions before. The person who was the director of that retired. So now the two groups are together, and I think that will even further enhance the capabilities and opportunities for school districts in the area of those media productions. And also, I did receive some information from WASB. the 2015-16 report to the membership. They asked that I share it with everyone. They sent this along with their membership bill for next year. And they do outline in here the member services. I guess we have a pile for Jane and a pile for Cindy, so I'll hand these down as well. Okay. You might want to take a look at that. And I would mention in particular, we have the board retreat coming up in July. And I would ask that you start thinking about the agenda, what you would like on that. And at one point, someone mentioned wanting to have a presenter, a facilitator. So you might want to take a look at what's in here, WASB, in the way of their services, or other suggestions that you have, both for the agenda and for a facilitator, speaker, whoever you would like to have. We need to know that as soon as possible because July is coming quickly. So please do let me know, let Linda know, so that we can get that put together to meet everybody's interests and needs. Okay, with that, we'll move ahead. Any committee reports anyone has? Hearing none. Budget report, Linda.
It's all on the agenda.
Okay. Action steps update, same thing. All right, moving to old business then. Facilities. Linda, do you have...
I'm looking for Rock.
Rock? I saw him before. There he's hiding.
Behind the wall.
Well, as far as facilities go, of course, as you can see in the hallways, that we're pretty well on our way to starting a lot of internal work. Most of the major projects that we had for the 15-16 budget year are pretty well on their way or are quite close to completion. We did find one thing today when we came to carpeting that we'd have to do a little bit more on some areas that needed carpeting. In other words, the subfloor wasn't as in good a shape as we thought it may be. So we may have to spend a little bit more day. But other than that, everything's moving along pretty well and should be pretty good by the end of June. So, any questions?
When was the, what's the update schedule on the sign? That was it.
The sign.
The sign.
Oh, yeah, the outside sign.
The first sign.
Like I say, I've been calling him probably once a week for the last several months now. And his last thing was that he told me was that we had a screw up on our end.
On our end or their end?
Their end. And I think what that means, he didn't give me any real specifics other than to say that I think what it means is that it didn't get ordered.
Huh?
So I said, well, do what you have to do, but it better be in the front of school by June 30th.
At least by start of school anyway.
That's pretty much where we're at.
Thanks, I didn't know that background. Yeah, I didn't ask.
Okay, any questions or comments regarding facilities? All right, thank you, Rock, and thank you to the staff that's working so hard to get everything ready for August. Yep, they'll be here doing, before we know it.
Yeah, they're doing a fantastic
yes,
job.
Yes, thank you. Mm-hmm. All right, item B under old business is the meet and confer guidelines, and we did have some things in the electronic material that we received, but I have another draft for you. Just a couple more that we've added based on some of the material that we got from other sources. You had the first eight, but there's 9 through 14 now. One of the other sources that we looked at talked about each team shall consist of no more than 5 members. Minutes of each meeting shall be maintained and distributed to all interested parties. All items discussed that need further discussion or action by the school board shall be placed on a timely school board agenda. All meetings of the meet and confer teams are to take place at the school outside of regular teaching hours and shall not interfere with other duties or school activities. Meetings can be held quarterly or on an as-needed basis. The Board of Education shall appoint 1 member to chair the meet and confer sessions. So I would open it up for your discussion. It's a starting point.
Yep, just to expand on the team, where each team shall consist of no more than 5 members.
Mm-hmm.
Like the meeting, the when a meet and confer happens, no more than 5 at that meeting, is that what the team is defined as?
5 from each team.
So 5 from the board and 5 from
right,
the staff or whatever group is meeting.
Right.
Oh, got it.
Right. And that there's not a magic number there.
It's I would just know what team was defined
right,
as.
Yeah.
I think you
it's just trying to keep it manageable.
Yeah, no, I
so to clarify, this small print that we have here, this is reference. These would be the guidelines for Sevastopol?
Right, at this point, and it's marked draft, so.
Okay.
All these other things are from other places that have, and there's a lot there. We can pick and choose whatever we want, whatever fits us. Some of the other districts are very prescribed in what they have. Others are more flexible. And what we have here is kind of a
summary, would you say?
Yeah, something kind of in the middle.
Well, it's in the middle. For what it's worth, I think it's a good start, and I would offer that.
And it,
if we get rolling down there and
find that it's not working,
we can make changes.
We can change it, right.
But it's pretty open, it's pretty flexible. I like less constraints or something like this, so I think that was a good thing.
But, you know, we wanted to move forward and in a timely fashion, so. If the board would like, we can start with these and see how they work and come back and review in 6 months or.
Are you looking for a motion to approve this now?
Yeah, I think we should have a motion.
I will move to approve the meet and confer guidelines.
No, sir.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? If not, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, that is approved. We'll move to new business. Item A is an action item to support staff 2016-17 salaries.
At the last meeting, we talked about a comparable increase for support staff as our teachers would be getting through alternative compensation because everyone has been held to CPI over the last several years. And I finished the spreadsheet and calculated the average overall increase. It is 10% for teachers. Therefore, I'm recommending that support staff have a 10% increase in salary. And so for some, it's like a 10% on their hourly wage.
That'd be a straight across the board.
Straight across?
Yeah.
I would, depending on the time, and I'd like to commit to making a decision that it will affect this whole entire school year's financial payout to the staff. But I think we should see if we can get some data to see how it compares to the other schools. Because that was earlier discussion we just had, right? Is some of that data would come and validate kind of some, industry competitiveness, which is what we've been saying. So,
it's going to take a while to collect. And I think that based on
July 1.
What we said last time, we're going to move forward with with the compensation structure. I don't think we should wait on this group as well. We can do our due diligence and make adjustments if we need to down the road. But I wouldn't feel comfortable delaying the support staff when we're moving forward with
the teaching staff.
Well, the only thing I would offer is what we talked about, it would be retroactive. So they would, whatever that balance would be, it would go back to the start of the fiscal year. And my only thing from my perspective is we had a body of data. And this, we agreed that, I mean, that we didn't put the same amount of effort into the support staff's package. I mean, for some reason, that's okay. But that was my only point. One opinion is we need to act on it. It needs to be evaluated. But for me personally, I don't have enough data to do that, to justify. It probably is dead right. Maybe it's more, maybe it's less. But usually that's where, and we talked about this with the teachers, is we need to be competitive with our schools. Mm-hmm. So if we're guessing at 10% for the support staff, I understand how you did the data. I get that. But I don't know what before or after, if we already knew consistently that it was exactly parallel and the 10% does apply, and you guys know that, I just don't have that background. And I don't think that was, I would tell the support staff, which I'm saying right now, is we're committed to doing that. And so stay tuned. When I am committed to making a decision, we will do that, and I'll do the research. But we don't have the data. That's my one opinion. So, but you guys have more history. So, like I said last meeting, if you guys have this, want to do it, charge off. But I'm just giving you my opinion on it. And one other thing I like that was noted, that maybe this is a quicker, because I'm not in school at the moment. I mean, so I can copy, right? And you said Southern Door had already done a study. I mean, if it's not too outdated, maybe that gives us adequate data, though. Is that a fair assessment in my head?
I don't know what the specifics of Southern Door's study are. And I want to make sure we're not talking about two different things, mm-hmm. because we were talking about a study of benefits
right.
for all of the staff last fall,
mm-hmm.
and right now we're talking about salary. We're not talking about changing the benefits with this recommendation. This is simply their increase in salaries, and not a change in benefits until we obviously look at that much.
But the only thing I don't understand is the, so maybe you guys have it, is my understanding of the pay structure for the staff, it factored in things like masters and all these other things. Mm-hmm. I honestly don't know, does that same type of hierarchy or structure factor in to the support staff? Meaning certain verifications and qualifications and stuff like that. Because that might throw off the percentage.
No, the support staff, for the most part, have an hourly wage. There are different wages depending on whether they've just started or whether they're here 6 months or 18 months, depending on what the job title is. But it's an hourly wage. And that hourly wage has been increased only by the CPI for the last 3 years.
So they've been under the same minimal increases as right. the teachers have?
Yes. Our lowest paid people have had the mm-hmm. CPI increase the same as the teachers.
Yeah, we're taking a leap of faith with the teachers, budget-wise and structure-wise, by pushing that forward. And I think that... I would move forward with that same equal mm-hmm. increase for the support staff. They've been waiting a long time as well.
Is that a motion, Bill?
And I would like to get that for them too. Do we? Mm-hmm. And it's a side note, but do we know what it costs? What that will cost?
$140,457.15 is the increase for both salary and benefits.
So I guess we could try to get the study first and retroactively give them whatever increase, or give the increase, and if an adjustment needs to be made after the study, do it next year.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to go ahead and make the motion that we move forward with 10% increase to the support staff.
I'll second.
We have a motion and a second. Any further discussion?
So just so we're implementing the 10% is the motion. And what was the comment about we'll do a study and then adjust at the end of the year?
Not at the end of the year, but we could either go wait and get the study and go retroactively, but that's not the motion. The motion is to do it now. But my comment was, after we get the study, if next year, the 2017-18 year, we feel that there was some inequity in the study, we can adjust.
Unless from what you guys have said in the past, which, don't get me wrong, people will get, but as, unless we, it was too high, we're not going to reduce.
We can't go back and take away, no.
You need a red circle, though. I mean, because it's more than just getting what the percentage, average percentage increase is. You've got larger schools, you got smaller schools, job responsibilities are going to be different. This is more than just taking a look at what they did over there. Mm-hmm. You're comparing jobs, size of the schools, job responsibilities, titles.
What you guys are doing don't make sense. I agree with what Dave's trying to say. Get a study and you can always retroactive pay them. Market. Find out what the market is.
May I ask Rob to give us an opinion?
Sure.
Rob?
Yes.
Where do our custodians compare with the other custodial jobs in the area?
Excuse me?
Where do our custodial salaries hourly compare with other custodial jobs in the area?
The only ones that I've ever seen any comparisons with some of the people at the government center.
Uh-huh.
And in that case, I believe the government center was actually paid more.
Okay.
But I don't know how much.
How about our bus drivers?
Bus drivers are paid more than our custodians are.
Are our bus drivers paid more or less than Sturgeon Bay?
Our bus drivers are paid more than Sturgeon Bay.
Okay.
To the
because
best
they
of the
because they use Cobison, right? Okay.
I mean, back, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Using
Cobison. Do you
know about
Southern Door?
I believe, I could say for sure, Linda. Okay. I'm pretty certain that we pay more than Southern Door, but I'm not sure. I think the only one that we pay less than is Gibraltar.
Okay. All right, thanks.
I do think we can get, I know a photography studio in Green Bay did it. It wasn't very expensive. He did a collection, and you got to factor in all the size of the business and stuff like that. And quite frankly, he ended up giving all the staff a raise too because of the, I think the 08-09 slowed a lot of people down. But and he, luckily, he was doing well enough. He paid all, you know. And he happened to be a friend of mine, so it wasn't a lot of work. He called somebody in, and they did that. So I thought, so if that earlier, the reference to this retired superintendent from Gibraltar was just for benefits, would they be, could we look at their pay or? Let me call and find out what company he had do that, because maybe there's a way we can get that at a reasonable cost, but get credible data, because I think people should be paid equity. That was why I did the other work, and you guys heard me talk last week, same thing. And that's all I think is would be the right thing to do. And sorry, that was discussion on the motion in a second. So
no,
you
I'm,
can still vote.
I'm wondering if we couldn't get some data rather quickly. Because it does involve more than the custodians.
It's custodians, bus drivers, food service, clerical.
Yeah, so it does involve quite a few categories of employees.
I guess strictly from a decision-making standpoint, mm-hmm. if we're going to be responsible, we should get data first.
Yes.
And then make the decision.
Yeah.
And that's not to take anything away from the support staff.
No,
I think we'll
commit to it.
I think we should commit and do it retroactively.
Then let's put a date on when
yes.
this will get done.
There you go. That works.
Do you want to withdraw your motion?
I'll withdraw the motion.
I'll withdraw soon.
I would like to see this done in 30 days. I think that's a reasonable amount of time to collect that.
Do you want to make a motion to that effect?
Make a motion that that a study is done for comparables to the existing staff, support staff, and that within the next 30 days that information is presented to the board for vote on increases.
I'll second.
You'll second that? Okay. Any further discussion?
Can we hire someone to do it?
Yeah, no, that was a discussion. Is
mm-hmm.
we haven't pinpointed Social Security number to do the work yet, and we got 30 days. So, I making this happen is going to happen. But I think maybe we revisit in 30 days, and I'll get data back to the board and Linda, or see what options I can scrounge up and see what we can figure out how to accomplish that.
And I will check with Jeff Dickard also to see if they could do that for us.
If someone call Southern Door and see if that would be credible data, because mm-hmm. I think your point is valid, Linda, that if they've been frozen for a while, with a similar logic, we need to adjust that.
Is there any way of you guys contacting
Mark Carroll, didn't he do this not that long ago and have all that data ready? I thought he investigated all the schools.
Could be. I can certainly contact him.
I would contact him and just see if he has any information.
Okay.
Just make a checklist, call the other superintendents on the phone. I'm certain they'll be happy to share that information with them. It'll take like about an hour.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? And that is approved. Thank you. Item B, to approve building and grounds transportation director contract, and we will take this up in closed session also. Item C, we talked about this at the last board meeting, that 0.12 CPI, whether or not that should be added to the 15-16 base salary. Linda?
It was added to the base salary so that...
Do we just need a motion on that?
I really just need a motion.
I move that we approve the 0.12 CPI for the base salary.
Second.
Okay, discussion? Anyone? Okay, hearing none. All in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That is approved. Item D, at our last meeting, there was some discussion about board having either a budget or a finance committee. In the past, years ago, we had a budget or finance committee with just a few board members and some community members. And then the board decided to go to a finance committee as a whole. And last week, the discussion came up, do we want a budget committee, a finance committee? Do we want to keep it as a whole? Do we want a separate committee? So we need to talk about that.
I still think it's a good idea. So there's a lot of these discussions because then we would have kind of an ongoing, I'm a process guy, right? So we have a process of people meeting on a regular basis. If we needed to do some analysis on people's salaries, that could be an ongoing discussion. We could have more time instead of, you know, geez, we got to make a decision right now. That's one of the upsides of a budget committee, and I think there would be like lots of committees. I assume there's more frequent times where you need to meet more often. And it might slow down and hey, everything's kind of stabilized and budget's in and revenues are clear. So I assume that. So I mean, it just, and then we had committees before and there's a bunch of references to a budget committee. So I don't know what we have to, I still think it's a good idea. And if we do the whole board, that's fine. I just haven't been in the past meetings, but we haven't had many detailed budget discussions. So my thought would be a smaller group that could, you know, let's face it, for me anyways, become more educated on the whole budget process and to influence our board decisions better. So,
do we want to just focus on budget or do we want to make it broader and focus on finance because it also involves state finance, grant funding?
No, that's good. That's probably what I don't understand. So that's the definition of budget and finance here is budget is just a school budget. Because I was just thinking money. We got to talk about money. So I like finance better because then we can talk about priorities for the SEF or the PTO or any other group that is willing to raise money, you know, or the anybody wants to raise money, then we can kind of start saying, hey, we're going after this and, you know, you can fund new bleachers and we'll go fund this as long as we're following all the rules. If that's, you know.
So does the board want to continue with the finance committee as a whole? Do you want a smaller committee? Do you want community members involved? Do you want just board members?
I think some of the ones that we reviewed had community members involved, you know, so and I don't see a problem with that. I think that's important. You know, at the end of the day, the board will make the decision, but, you know, it'll help with the transparency and communicating. And I think the other reason the finance is important because sooner or later we'll have to deal with the facility, and that is going to be a big issue with finance. And the more we can sculpt that and get the community on board is critical. So that's maybe the other thing about the importance of the finance committee now is start ramping up.
So the finance committee then would be taking over the buildings and grounds committee then?
No, I think there's a difference in my head.
Yeah.
The building and grounds, okay, forgive me, I'm an engineer, right? There is the aspect of the design and the capability and the size and all the air conditioning performances that you would work with the architect side. So that's kind of like the building scoping and sizing and what carpet do you want and stuff like that. Where do we put it on the grounds or how do we attach to this building? That's more the what I was thinking, building and grounds.
But
and
see, in the past, they've started taking the lead on that, you know, when we got the information.
Sure, as long as we're doing it. And,
it seems like we have someone that has a passion for finance, so it seems like you're the person, Dave. So what if Dave puts together a structure of what he thinks the finance committee looks like, a finance committee looks like, their goals and possible membership?
Okay, I'll give her a go, and I'll give it to you. And then, because what I don't know about all this parliamentary procedure stuff is my committees that I would recommend are flexible, which we've talked about, so we can get her going, and all of a sudden, you know, Jay comes in and says, hey, here's an idea, and it's a great idea. Well, let's adjust slightly and move on that. So I'll do that. I'll put together a recommendation.
You want to bring that back to the next meeting?
Sure. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, item E. We're asked to put on the agenda a video audio record of board meetings, and Linda has some thoughts on that.
It was just to ask the board what they wanted.
Because talk a little bit about the recording that we have.
We have a problem with our recorder. It doesn't store, it doesn't produce good quality, and the platform is not user-friendly at all. And so most of the time when somebody asks for one and we put it on a flash drive or we try to email, it doesn't work. Nina can't email it to me. I can't open it up. So we have a couple of issues. One is if you want better quality, you need to buy a new camera. And two, do you want the recordings of the board meetings posted on YouTube to a connection on our website? Because that was one of the suggestions that was made.
Right. Yeah. And Bill, I think you had some thoughts on that as well.
I do. I worry about, in particular, in the last few months, the rhetoric, the accusations, the things that were brought about, those really can be looked at from a slander standpoint, and put those out there. To simply put it out on YouTube, that means we're condoning that. I think that if it's available, like we have it now, for somebody to request, it gives us the ability to review it and redact to protect those individuals that that may be either talking or...
The only thing I would say is it is a public meeting and people have to be held accountable. So if they say something that is illegal or something like that, they can be held accountable for that. I mean, there's a lot of public meetings, you know, and I'm a big advocate for freedom of speech, obviously, with my background. So, you know, when it's a public meeting, so... I personally don't want to be on YouTube, I guarantee that. Anyone who knows me, I don't like that kind of stuff. But it's a good discussion to have, you know. In today's day and age, where, you know, something happens and everybody's aware of it in 10 minutes, you know, that's even legal, you know.
I think that part of the issue is that if we post it, then we are party to defamation. If we have it and we give it to someone because they've asked for it and they choose to post it, we are no longer a party to that defamation.
How do they get through that? And maybe it's not a concern to them, but there are a lot of, like Sturgeon Bay has it on the TV, right? So that's publicly broadcast, live, I think, in fact. So. Wouldn't this be similar to that?
But it's not on YouTube. That's the difference.
Why could this not be on Sevastopol TV?
I talked to Lanny Chapman. He's not charging us tonight. He's just recording for someone. It can be on the Sevastopol TV channel if, you know, he requests it from the school and gets it. He can put it on the Sevastopol channel. I had people asking about having it more readily available because there aren't a large group of people in our district that get the cable channel.
No, I don't get it. I don't get it. So YouTube would be a good spot.
So I think my personal assessment is that risk is pretty low. I do think that more visibility would prevent stuff like that in these last few months, quite frankly, because then, you know, there's lack of knowing people's perceptions and would run amok. So now we can say, go review them all and see what we've been discussions we've been having and what our meetings are. So.
Are you saying you want to purchase a new camera?
I guess if that's...
A microphone.
That's... I guess, yeah. So number one, I personally think we need to do it, and I'm not saying I want to do it, and therefore I think we got to do what you said, is probably provide the equipment to do it.
Do you want a legal opinion before you direct us to post it on YouTube?
Sure. I'm good with that. Absolutely. You betcha. No, legal counsel is better.
Okay. Very quickly, two comments, and then we're going to move on.
My comment is, why not pull the other schools in the district, in the county, and see what they're doing?
I'm pretty sure Surge Bay has it on their website. I've been able to watch it personally. I'm not exactly sure about Southern Door or Gibraltar, but if we're going to be competitive, why not check other school districts and see how they're doing it and how they're dealing with it legally?
Thank you.
In order to get more community in here and really being for the community to really know what's going on within our school and in our district, you kind of have to have it more publicly available.
Thank you. One more comment and then we're moving on.
I feel that there's a group of people, parents and young children and elderly, and my mom, for example, is ill and my dad has to take care of her. So there's people in a need out there that would like to see what's going on, like to hear about our budget, maybe help with the referendum if they can hear what's all going on in these meetings, and it would be helpful if they knew that. The good, the bad, the ugly, whatever it is, it all should be shared.
Thank you.
So I guess what we want is a legal opinion and then maybe the cost on new equipment.
Right.
And what it would take to make it easy to transfer it onto online or onto a thumb drive or whatever.
We'll come back to that item again. All right, item F, goal setting. We typically do this during our summer retreat, and I think everybody has copies of the goals from last year. We start by working off of those, so we need to be thinking about that in preparation for that retreat, and Linda usually brings us lots of information that we can utilize input from staff and input from the principals and others. So anything you want to add to that, Linda?
Just wanted to know if there was anything new or different that people wanted at that meeting.
For the goal supporting staff.
Anyone?
Well, I thought it was, if you have some kind of facilitator, that might be a good addition, to help us along.
Okay. Got it. If you have any suggestions of anyone,
is this part of it? Is when we craft our goals or revisit the goals, do we kind of revisit, talk about what actions are we as a school taking to achieve those goals?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay. Good. Perfect.
Absolutely. Okay. Item G. 2016-17 preliminary budget approval.
Yes. I believe everyone received this document. That is the lion's share of the supplies, services, contracts, and Nina went through. This is a working document, so it doesn't actually go in order like you're accustomed to seeing it until it's locked down. But if you go to the bottom line, we have $2,256,456.74 there. Basically, this is the stuff that we purchase to run the school district. And you also received the spreadsheet with the teacher's compensation and the increase that that's going to require. So the pieces that we don't have at this point are the increase for support staff, for our professional contracted personnel, and at least for the teachers, the benefits associated other than the increase in FICA and retirement. So you've got all of the big pieces, with the exception of those things, and we need to ask you to approve that preliminary budget at this time so we're ready for July 1st.
Okay. Could we have a motion and a second, and then we'll have discussion?
I move we approve the budget as presented.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Discussion.
Can you remind us what personal services are under all these?
Well, that's one of those things that has changed. And so personal services is a lot bigger than it used to be. We used to have conference fees, everything that, you know, dues, fees, what you'd pay to go into the new zoo, all of those things that you would pay were a 949 number, and DPI changed and said that those were actually personal service. So now personal service includes everything in addition to paying a consultant to come for something, like on a 1099, to how much we pay for tickets, to workshop and conference costs, tuition for courses. Personal services has just grown tremendously because of the change that DPI made in the woofer codes.
And what I would offer through the discussion on that is, I think the timelines, we need to approve this budget, right? And tomorrow, I don't think whoever's going to write a check for $2 million tomorrow. We get rolling. And if we can figure out something that we can staff and get the right people, and I don't even know if Nina's an option, but to get the right people in some type of a committee, we can start answering all those questions slowly, not over time. So then if we all know what the woofer codes are, and, you know, those things we try to walk them through, and what personal services mean, because we should, within reason, not the 40 pages or whatever. So that's for what it's worth, I say we approve the budget, and then knowing, you know, we're still here. We'll keep following the budget throughout the next year and become smarter if needed. You guys might be there.
Other discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Aye. That is approved. Item H, we have a request for an overnight student trip and some documentation from Cheryl Feaster.
Yes. Cheryl found something great she wanted kids to do this summer. So she is proposing an overnight field trip. This is, we usually get these proposals a lot sooner than this, but this is something that came up that she would really like students to take advantage of. It involves going down to Oregon, Wisconsin, and because of the time of the performance in the evening, they would be spending the night and coming back the next day. And does anyone need me to read Cheryl's handwriting?
No, I think we've all read that.
Yeah,
make
that.
She's probably used a typer.
One of the questions that came up was that she didn't seem to have a male chaperone. And so she worked on that last day, and Mr. Spetz is willing to go with her as the male chaperone. So we recommend that you approve this overnight trip.
What is the effect of, because I think if I read all the ink right, is the students will pay for it. So what is the effect on the school? Is
there
two vans, I guess?
The tickets are $12 plus the meals. They're estimating they need 5 hotel rooms. Said students and their families will pay some of the costs, and the drama activity will pay some of the costs. Okay. She doesn't have all the details worked out yet because she doesn't know how much housing is going to be yet. They might be able to get down in our two vans.
That's all. Are we approving the use of the vans or the budget to go?
No, we'll take care of the van part. You're approving the overnight trip.
There had been policies in the past about not allowing overnight trips, and that loosened up probably a year or two ago.
Mm-hmm.
And it was based on issues that had happened in the past with overnight trips. So at one point, the board decided
we approve
no more, no more. But then other things came up, and we loosened up those reins.
Mm-hmm. Well, and we put together some guidelines, mm-hmm. right? Some information that was needed ahead of time, so that good planning would take place and yeah. everyone would be aware of what the expectations were.
I know when I was in school, we went down and saw a play that we actually did, you know, that fall.
Yep. No,
and it's a big help for them.
Yeah. And that's what they're going to do.
We went to Milwaukee that time to see that.
And there's no problem with insurance in the van over the summer because we're not in school.
Yeah,
so that's because we're insured year-round with our stuff. So if it's a school function that we approve.
Yeah, it is a student activity.
Okay. Could we have a motion then to approve the overnight student trip request?
I will so move to approve.
Is there a second?
A second.
Any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? That is approved. Item I, Fund 46 request. This is a fund that we started last year to be able to put aside some funding to be used at a later time. And building improvement obviously was one area that we had in mind with this. So.
There are some really strict rules to establish a Fund 46. You have to have your 10-year capital improvement plan. You have to have a separate account for Fund 46. It can't be commingled with your other finances, and you may only transfer money from Fund 10 to Fund 46. And if you want to transfer money, it needs to be done before June 30th of each year. Last year, because we were just going through all of those hoops to establish the fund, $100 went into it just so that we would have that, because there's a limitation on it as well. You cannot spend money until it's been in there for 5 years. So we needed to establish the fund. It's close to June 30th.
Mm-hmm.
We've talked about fund balance, and at the last meeting mentioned that you might want to think about depositing some money into Fund 46 this year.
Go ahead and move to deposit, I think we talked about $1,000
mm-hmm.
into Fund 46 from Fund 10.
I see.
We have a motion and a second to move $1,000 from Fund 10 to Fund 46. Can we transfer in at any time?
You can at any time during the year.
Okay.
It's just that if you want it to count from a fiscal year, it needs to be by June 30th.
Right.
Because we also have to do a report on Fund 46.
Right. When it counts for a fiscal year, does that give us a tax break, or what's the benefit of counting for the fiscal year? I don't understand.
No, we don't pay taxes.
No.
It's a requirement of the state reporting requirement.
Timeline.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And I'm sorry, forgive me. Fund 46 is paying for building stuff, the stuff again.
Right now it's a savings account.
Yeah, in case like our future efforts come together, mm-hmm. Okay, it could be a... It would be the account where we would start moving.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Hearing no further discussion, all in favor of the motion say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? That is approved. This concludes our open session. We now need a motion to reconvene in executive session.
I will so move.
We need a second.
Second.
We have a motion and a second, and we'll do a roll call vote. Dave?
Aye.
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 Okay. We will reconvene in executive session.